Hey, what's up, everybody? It's time for your favorite radio show. It's the Kevin and Nikki Show on iHeartRadio. Let's go.
Yeah. Overdose. It's time for the Kevin and Nikki Show. They gon' have it lit up. Yeah, you know, it's time for the Kevin and Nikki Show. They got the airwaves popping every city across the globe. It's time for the Kevin and Nikki Show. They gon' have it lit up. Yeah, you know, it's time for the Kevin and Nikki Show. They got the airwaves popping every city across the globe. You know him as a dope actor, Kevin D. Benton. 360 twice, Jim, how you keep winning? And you know the baddest actress, Nikki won. She's so bad you walking past, she had you speaking for her. If you ain't tuning in, this your reality check. You might miss out on your favorite star celebrity guest. When they celebrate, what you do, you get the bell, yeah. During Kevin's corner, get inspired and encouraged, yeah. Bend them corners while you listen, but don't swerve. Find out what's getting on Nikki nerves. What's bothering Nikki? What's bothering Nick Nick? What's bothering Nikki? What's bothering Nick Nick? Keep on playing. Me and Kevin Coons and we gon' get you hit. Yo, check us out on social media. In your mobile phone, we everywhere. You other stations played out like a ringtone. Follow me like Beano, R-E-M-E-Y. Beano Remy. Pop like Sammy. And my flow hotter. Take a semi. Been doing this since I scraped up pennies. But back to the subject, Kevin Nikki.
Texting Longhorn too.
Yeah, he always says that. In Denzel Washington says, "My man,
my man,
that's what Denzel Washington says. My man.
Yeah. All right. So we are back. We are back. We are back.
What is that? What is
that? That was my. I had to hold it like I was in the opera.
I had to hold it
like I was an opera. Mm-hmm. So it
what
is.
What opera are you talking about?
Any opera. Okay. That's just how they sing an opera.
No, they don't.
Figaro, 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 Figaro.
That's how they sing an opera. Some of the opera.
Ain't I can hold it that long, did you?
You know what?
I got some hidden talents, man. I'm serious.
You do.
Look, I was an opera patron in the upside, so I know how it go down. You know what I mean?
Okay.
Yeah.
We should have put you on stage with the lady. The
what was it? Remember, was it Flower Lady and Birdman? Who was the other guy in the costume? Tree Man. That's what it was.
Yeah.
Tree Man, yeah. But that lady, she was killing it, wasn't it?
She was.
Yeah, she was killing it.
She was. You know who she sound like? She sound like that lady in The Fifth Element.
Yeah.
Man, lady.
Yeah.
She's
yeah.
Like,
yeah.
That's what she sounded like.
Yeah, that was good. That was really, really good.
Yeah.
So anyway, it is the Kevin and Nikki Show on iHeartRadio, and we are back for another exciting episode.
Yes.
Another exciting show.
Yes.
Another exciting guest.
Yes.
Exciting conversations. Another exciting flow.
Yes.
It's gonna be all that.
All the way live.
All the way live. Mm. All the way live. What movie was that?
That's not a movie. It's a song.
No. That was a song that was in a movie. I want to say it was a basketball movie. I want to say like Mike or something like that. I don't know.
Okay.
When you said all the way live, that's what I thought about.
All right. But let me ask you this: Would you be able to sit through a whole opera experience, the entire experience, without doing one of these?
Without going to sleep.
Yes.
I definitely could do it. I'm going to tell you why.
Okay.
If I pay $300 for a ticket, I'm going to be wide-eyed and awoke the whole time. Because so. I'm going to get my experience out of that
$300. I don't think so.
You don't think so?
I don't think so.
Why you don't think so?
I think you're going to be asleep. I think you'll probably go to sleep after intermission.
Nah, I don't think so.
I'm telling you, I think you'll
If I paid a lot of money for a ticket, I would purpose to stay up. I would make sure I stay up. Even if I had to run across the street and buy a Pepsi and come back, for $300, I'm not falling asleep.
For real. Okay. And I smell a challenge.
You ain't said nothing but a word. Trust me. If I pay $300 for an opera seat, I'm not falling asleep.
Kev, I'm telling you, you're going to fall asleep.
I bet you I won't.
I bet you you won't.
I'm not wasting no $300.
Okay.
I'm going to be able to tell you what happened from start to finish.
Okay.
I'm going to be able to tell you where everybody was sitting in the auditorium. Okay. That's how close I'm going to be paying attention.
Because I know you're going to be like this. You're going to be paying attention. The next thing you know, them eyes going to shut.
As soon as one just about to shut, yeah, I'm going to think about that $300. I'm going to open up eyes right back up. You know
what I mean? Yeah, right.
Like caffeine, I'm open right back up.
You know what? I'm not going to. Y'all don't forget this day.
You don't understand.
Don't forget this
I'm
day.
I'm not wasting no.
Listen. You heard it here first. As soon as the theater experience opens up and we can go back to the theater, I'm going to take Kev. The tickets may not be $300.
If it's a good one, it's going to be like, and that was a bare minimum. You can pick up to $500 for opera
where they're, oh.
I understand okay. that. I'm saying a good opera, around $300 would be kind of like minimum to mid cost.
Okay.
Now, I will admit, I fall asleep in a movie theater now, and I have. But for $300,
okay,
I will stay awake the whole time.
All right.
Yeah.
Okay.
I would be able to tell you what everybody in the auditorium is wearing. Trust me.
Yeah, because you'll scan it beforehand.
No, I'm going to scan it before, during the middle, intermission, and after.
Okay.
I'm not wasting the $300, man. Seriously. And if you pay for them, I wouldn't want to waste it. I definitely wouldn't want to waste it.
Mm-hmm. Those tickets.
If you pay $300 for me to go, you saw me over there. You can't tell me you wouldn't be upset.
I'll be poking you like, wake up.
Well, all right.
Those tickets are high.
They high.
They are, but you know those are the good shows because you know those tickets for Hamilton, from what I understand, back in 2016,
it was like $400 or $500.
Yeah, and that's why a lot of people were very happy that it came out on Disney Plus. They got an opportunity to see it. But I'm going to say, I know we like that theater experience and everything, but I like the close up from the camera when it came out on Disney Plus.
Oh, gotcha.
You got to see everything. You got to see stuff you weren't even supposed to see.
I know. Yeah.
You know, people standing around not doing nothing. I saw all of that,
right.
Hamilton.
Right,
I saw it all. People standing on the steps waiting for their cue and stuff. They not supposed to be in camera.
To my understanding, they were supposed to be in the background, right?
But you're not supposed to be seen. But okay. I saw somebody go off to the side. And they were like this.
Okay.
Waiting for the kid.
Okay.
Like, okay. Right. Look at that person over there. Right.
So you know what? It's just like an actor would know what to look for watching a movie.
Uh-huh.
Like, we can tell everybody that looked into the camera. We can tell who didn't have continuity. We can pick those things. And so I guess you, with your strong theater mm-hmm. background, you're able to pick up those things.
Yeah.
You know.
Like, them. What was that movie we were watching a while ago? Bad Boys for Life.
Mm-hmm.
Remember the part where they threw the man off of the balcony and he crashed down on the hood.
Yeah.
And everybody just walking by they didn't see it.
And then the old man that walked behind didn't show no emotion.
Listen, people, you have to take this thing and you have to put it in the natural. What would your reaction be if you saw that for real? Y'all be whipping out y'all phones, trying to get a picture, trying to, like, what is it, Facebook Live, the whole nine. Y'all be jumping, screaming. Somebody would put their hands over their mouth.
Right,
nobody
right.
did nothing.
Right, right. They were just walking by.
Just walking by.
You
no
could
reaction.
Tell that, you know, there was a assistant director or DP that was saying, okay, your turn to walk by. Because some people didn't even look at the action. Some people just walk right by.
Exactly.
And kept their head straight.
The whole time.
Yeah. If you were in, like you said, in that situation for real, you would look, you would slow down, you put your hand over your mouth, like you said, pull out your cell phone. You know, you might even run, speed up, and walk away or whatever as fast as you can if you've seen a dead body just drop on top of a car like that. You know what I mean?
Let me tell you something. Put me in the movie next time and watch what y'all get from me. Y'all be like,
you would fall out like the women, like the women in church, wouldn't you?
You already know. I would get an Oscar that day. I'm trying to tell you. Put me in the movie and see what you get next time. I'm trying to tell you.
I know, right?
For real.
You know what? But it's real interesting. And, of course, not knocking anybody's opportunity. And Bad Boys for Life was a great movie. You know, full of action. It was funny. You know, you took it for what it was worth. Mm-hmm. Depending on what kind of genre you like and what you expect, your opinion might be different of mine. That's okay. But when you see that, you're kind of sitting back there like Jim Carrey was in, what was it, Pet Detective? Coach, put me in the game. Just give me a chance. You know what I'm saying? Just want the chance to show somebody this is how you do it. Now, what experience did that remind you of?
Nobody flinched or nothing.
What experience, what set were we on? I know you're going to get this. That it reminds you of where people were supposed to be reacting to what was going on. This should be an easy one. And they wasn't. And we were sitting there like, please put us there. And then they finally put us there right across from the lead actors who we later got pictures with backstage. Who?
The upside.
We were sitting there like,
what in the world is going on?
Yeah. I mean, you had the one lady, of course, not knocking anybody's gift, talents, and abilities or whatever, sitting right next to Kevin Hart and Bryan Cranston.
Yeah.
Kevin Hart, if you saw the movie, was talking in the opera. That is horrible etiquette for opera.
Not only horrible etiquette, but like you said, them tickets was $300-some-odd.
Right. So that would have made me... You know what? Now that you said that... Mm-hmm. Now remember, we finally got the opportunity the second half of the day to sit one across the aisle from Kevin Hart and Bryan Cranston. Mm-hmm. And we was giving them the death stare.
We sure
Because
are.
You know what was going through my mind? I paid $300 for these tickets. And you are talking in the... That was the character I got into. Mm-hmm. That helped me mm-hmm. look at him and stare at him, you know, at the way... You know, to help me get into mm-hmm. the character. Mm-hmm. And we gave him the death stare. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. And so, yeah. We were sitting there like, okay, somebody sitting next to you being loud in the opera... You're at least supposed to look in their direction.
You're supposed to do something.
They wasn't even looking. The director, what was the director? Oh, am I supposed to know this? I can't slip in my mind right now. The director of The Upside, Neil Berger, came down the steps personally.
Yes, he did.
He walked past us and went to the people in front of us and was like, hey, I need y'all to give me a little bit more.
Yes, right.
He said, I need y'all to give me a little bit more, man.
That's right.
You know, and
that's right.
Some of this acting thing, in fact, a lot of it, maybe even most of it, is how would you think, feel, believe, or behave, or react if that was your situation?
For real, I'm telling you right now, listen, a dead body, period, even a horror movie, mm-hmm. I don't care. I'm going to be really scared.
I'm going to be really scared.
Listen,
too.
You can't, I understand that. You know, we're supposed to act and different things like that. But part of movie magic...
No, we're not supposed to act. I mean, remember, don't get caught. So,
that's right. Movie magic is creating that assumption that it is real.
Right.
Now, you see a darn dead body dropping 50 feet or whatever, crashing down on top of the car, and you don't even flinch.
Right.
You don't even look. You don't turn around. You don't do nothing. You just keep on walking like a zombie. That ain't real.
Right, that's not real.
I'm sorry. I would have fell all on the ground.
Right.
I would have been screaming the whole nine. I mean,
you would have got featured after all
that. Yes, let me tell you something. For real.
Remember that scene that the kid Dillard sent us?
Oh, my goodness.
Where,
I got to find it.
We got to find that. That is so funny. We're going to post that on our show page where there was a shooting. And one of the kids got shot and started breakdancing and spinning on his head before he died. And it was like, the caption was, don't do this on set to get featured.
Yes. Now, I would have done all that. But it darn sure would have been realistic.
Yeah.
I mean, come on. I'm like, these people ain't even... And you know how you're watching a movie. And the first time you're watching it for entertainment.
Right.
And then when you go back and you start watching it with your actor, I went, wait a minute.
Yeah.
some people ain't even moved.
Right.
You know.
Yeah. So, yeah.
Just give me a chance. Please, come on, coach. Put me in the game, coach.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. Mm-hmm. Well, as always, as you can see, a lot to talk about, a lot going on.
Yeah.
So without further ado, it is now time for the Billy Adventures of Kevin and Nikee.
All right.
Yeah. All right. All right, so what's going on in Nikee's world?
Man, let me tell you something. I had so much fun over the weekend. Mm-hmm. Oh, my goodness. Shout out to Shamar Jeter beautiful bride, Camille Jeter.
Yeah.
Man, we had so much fun with them. All right, listen. I'm going to set this up.
Right.
So, and shout out to Kev for asking me to come along and help. Kev got asked by Shamar Jeter, one of our acting friends and friends to the show, to bartend his wedding. And Kev was like, Nick, can you come and help me? Because I don't know how many people is going to be there and different things like that. And, you know, I just wanted to go right. Now, mind you, we don't have no bartending license.
Right.
But they didn't know that.
That's right.
And you couldn't tell them that we didn't.
That's right.
Listen, we came. We were professional. Kev had on the black and white with the black bow tie. I had on the black and white with the white bow tie. We had on our mask. We got there. We was like, Kev, we're going to set this up.
We organized.
Yeah. Right? We organized the bar and everything. And them, man, let me tell you, them people were coming over. And the main, listen, after a while, they didn't want any of the drinks that was on the list. They wanted that, what was it called?
The woo-woo.
The woo-woo.
Yeah.
And for those of y'all
we ain't going to tell them how to make it. We ain't promoting drinking ourselves.
Okay. We're not
going to. We don't drink. And we ain't promoting drinking on our show.
The funny part about it is that one of the guests was like, y'all drink? We said, no. He said, well, how y'all bartenders and y'all don't drink? I said, you drink. That's all that matters.
Right, that's right. But you know what?
We had so much
fun. But here's the thing, though. We was over there guzzling down the Sunkist and Pepsi.
We sure was.
But we was fixing them liquor.
We drinking up all the Pepsi in the Sunkist and fixing them the liquor.
That's it.
Man, I'm telling you, we were over there dancing and carrying them.
They had
a ball with us. You could not tell them people that we were not professionals.
Yeah. You know, I think what it was, we drew from our acting skills.
Yeah.
First of all, we came wardrobe ready.
Yes, we were.
We looked like professional bartenders.
Yes. We both had on vests.
Yeah, we had on black vests. Black and white bow ties.
Yep.
And so that was for starters. And then, you know, we went out and bought the measuring cups.
So
we can
cups.
Get the right amount.
The measuring shot cups.
Yeah, the measuring shot cups.
Yes.
We gave everybody a little extra something.
Because, you know, you get like 1/4 for this. I said, Kevin, everybody get two.
We kept it simple. You know what I'm saying?
It worked.
So we had this piece of paper that Shamar provided for
us.
We were fixing 4 drinks. And what we did was we organized the various different bottles
according to the first drink.
Then next to that was for the second drink and third and fourth and so on. But the drink of the day, which wasn't on the list, was the woo woo.
The woo woo.
And we gotta give a shout out to the executive director of Chase Street.
Uh-huh.
He was putting us down with the 411.
Yes, he
did. And that drink took over. Everybody wanted the woo woo.
Let me tell you something. This one guy came back like 19 times. Yeah. I counted.
Yeah, yeah.
If he got between the woo woo, the Long Island iced tea, and he drank up all the Coronas.
Yeah.
He drank them Coronas.
He kept
coming back.
He sure did.
Even the guy who put us down with the woo woo kept coming back.
We had to cut down his portions. And
yes, we did.
Fill his with more cranberry juice and orange juice.
Because we had
to look out for him so he can get home safely.
He was getting too gussy.
Yeah.
So his wife was like, don't give him no more. But he kept coming back. So we had, like you said,
we had to put more fruit in. Plain fruit drinks. just to kind of, take care of
them. Tell them about the fruit punch. Tell them about the fruit punch.
The fruit punch?
The fruit punch. The two big jugs of fruit punch that they brought out that was regular juice.
Yeah.
We started mixing that with alcohol.
That's it. That's it. We started mixing that up, and they was loving it.
The lady said, "What's that?" I said, "That's fruit punch."
That's it.
She said, "That's all." I said, "Well, you want some sauce in it? We can put some sauce in it. We can fix that.
That's it.
And they tipped us lovely.
Yeah, they sure did.
Yes.
Sure did. And my whole thing was, my best friend asked me to come support him, and I wanted to support him. If he didn't ask me to, bartend particularly, I still would have come to support him.
Right.
But, just to be able to help out and serve in that capacity.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And here's the thing. I talked to Nikee about this afterwards. We don't drink. You know what I'm saying? We don't drink. And this is an oxymoron. We don't drink, but we're serving the liquor and stuff like that.
Can tell them that.
Right. But we was over there having a good time. The way we was having fun, you would have thought we were drinking.
Yes.
But we were having so much fun, just dancing and just having a great time. And this is what I learned. You can go into environments and be yourself and do you and still show love and support and not be judgmental of other people. And that stuff not only goes a long way, but it's more impactful that, I don't drink. I'm not serving this. Because whether we came or not, they was going to serve it anyway.
Uh-huh.
You know what I'm saying? And it was, of course, we did the best we could to act responsible. We were kind of holding people accountable.
Yeah,
all right, now, this is just, it's your
third
one, man. We need you to, who's your designated? We were asking, who's your designated driver?
Mm-hmm.
Blah, 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 blah. But it was all in the name of love and support for a beautiful couple. And celebrating their happiness on their wedding day. Everything was fantastic. It was very beautiful.
The food was delicious.
The food was delicious. It was catered. The scenery in the backyard was
purple and white. Purple and white was the color.
It was the color. It was just great, man. And I'm going to tell you, man, I'm going to keep it real, man. I was so proud of Shamar and his lovely bride.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it made me feel like my eyes wanted to just tear up because I know how hard he's worked and I know how she has been an excellent support to him. And I remember they were actually on set together. I think I want to say it was FBI. And when I saw that, I said, you know what? It's something unique about them.
Mm-hmm.
You could see a unity. Mm-hmm. There was a togetherness. Mm-hmm. There was a, example of love there. And I wish them much peace, much joy, much success, much happiness, and much love, man. And we were honored to be a part of because that's intimate. Anytime somebody invites you to their wedding or into their home, that's personal and that's intimate. And to be invited, I wasn't going to let him down. Yeah. So I had to call in reinforcements, had to call him back up with Nick.
Mm-hmm.
And we made every drink together. Nikee would hold the cup, I would pour, vice versa. We just kind of just tag team it, but everybody was happy.
Yes, they were.
Everybody got home safely. And we just had a fantastic time.
Yes.
It was great, man.
Yeah, Shamar and his wife drank up some of them woo-woos, too.
They sure did.
They had a few woo-woos.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah,
And then when the woo-woos ran out, we made the whoop-de-doo.
We sure did.
We made the whoop-de-doo at the end.
Yeah, because what did we run out of?
We ran out of snaps. Yeah, yeah.
We ran out of peach snaps.
Yeah.
And we made the whoop-de-doo out of whatever we had up there.
Man.
They were drinking that up, They were drinking it up.
Now, I was sitting there like, man, our folks can drink, can't they? Listen. A good way to get our people to come to a function, we got a DJ, and the DJ, he did a solid job.
Yeah.
He did a solid job.
Yeah.
He did a
solid
job.
But I'm going to tell you right now, there was a Caucasian lady there.
Mm-hmm.
She started out with the Long Island iced tea.
Yeah.
I saw her come over to that table, and the last time she came over, she was actually staggering. And I said, what you going to get now? She said, I'm gonna try. I'm like, what? What you trying to say?
Yeah, I
know. So, she was a little tipsy too.
And that was after the first one.
Man. She was a little tipsy too, staggered over to the table. Then she started staring at the bar. She was staggered over to the bar, and then she started staring at the bar like she wanted to come back, but she didn't know what she wanted.
Right.
Man, that was funny as crap.
So it was great, man. But I'm going to tell you, when that bar opened up, the floodgates opened. Folks were just, let me get this, let me get that. And we handled it. We had a good time.
I'm trying to tell you.
We handled it.
They saw that bar. Because we set that bar up quick.
Yeah, we did.
We didn't waste no time.
Yeah, we did.
We set that bar up real quick. And as soon as we set the bar up,
here they come. Boy, they was,
here they come.
And they would finish one, and they would come right on back. It was like, man. But it was great to be a part of.
Yeah, but they got upset with us when we turned them bar lights off.
Oh, yeah. We had to eat, too. When we turned the bar, I said, Mommy, look, can you give us 3 minutes, you know? Oh, y'all eating?
Yes.
Yeah.
Shamar came up and was like, y'all go over there and get something to eat.
Yeah.
Turn this down. Go eat.
We had to do whatever y'all want to do.
Turn it down. Y'all not going to be staying over here while everybody else is doing whatever. Y'all go eat. I was like, okay.
And we had to pull the lights out to turn the blinking lights off so we could let them know they were shut down. They still was coming over. We're like, look, we'll be over there in about, give us about 3 more minutes. But it was great, man. It was great, man. It was a fantastic moment in time, and it was just great to be a part of, man.
Yeah, it was great to be a part of. Shamar and his bride, they sang a song together.
Yeah,
and she kept saying, "I don't sing." They had it for a minute. It was a little bit off key, but they had it.
Right.
That was cute too. Yeah. Dancing around it. It was cute.
It was great.
It was really good.
It was great.
It was really good. I had a fabulous time.
Yeah. Them little kids. Oh, I think somebody slipped something in their drink because they was. They must put some sugar in their Kool-Aid.
Those kids had a little bit of Gussie, too.
I think so. They were ripping and running off. Yes, they were on the dance floor, running around the trees.
Oh, my goodness.
Chasing
they
each
were
other
the whole time. They didn't even sit there. Did they eat?
I don't think they ate. They were having so much fun. You would have thought it was their little wedding. You know what I mean?
Oh, my goodness. I know.
And then the little boy that kept chasing the little girl. Where's his mom at? You know what I mean?
Shut up.
Whose kid is this? You know what I mean?
Where is your mother?
Yeah, man. But it was great.
We had a good time.
It was good. It was really,
we had a lot of fun with that. A lot of fun with that.
Yeah.
I kind of want to say, y'all, let's let them get married again so we can go back. But you only supposed to get married once.
That's it.
Okay.
Yeah.
Some people get married like 18 times. We ain't going to say no names. But
that's right. When they say one time kiss the pig, that means you get one chance to do one opportunity, one time at one place in life, and that's it.
Some people go back for 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Like, dang, how many husbands you gonna have?
Yeah.
Shoot,
goodness gracious.
Okay,
so, but anything else? That was the highlight of the weekend.
The wedding.
Yeah, that sure was.
They could have made a movie out. We could have made a movie out of that. Yeah. The way we were acting behind that darn bar, dancing and carrying on.
Yeah, it was.
But we had them people cracking up.
They sure was, and it was kind of fairy tale too, man. With the white and the purple and the music, it was kind of fairy tale, man. You know, and I think what every woman would kind of dream of in terms of the wedding, and it was great, man. It was great.
It was nice, and the crazy part is that we thought that it was going to be the reception only, and it turned out to be the entire wedding. I'm like,
and the reception.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Look, we're going to need some more liquor.
Yeah.
Yes,
it was great. So, other than that, man, as I mentioned last week on the show, the episode that I was in, season 1, episode 3 of Book of Power 2, Ghosts, came on, it aired, and I just want to give a shout out, I say thank you from the top, middle, and bottom of my heart for everybody that showed me a lot of love,
they sure did.
A lot of encouragement, a lot of motivation, inspiration, and support. Mm-hmm. People were just flooding my timeline, reposting the video episode of my scene.
Yeah.
I got calls, I got text messages. I got so many messages. If I haven't responded, I will respond. I haven't been on social media as much since it has aired because I've been kind of, busy doing some other things and things like that, particularly preparing for the show and things like that. And but if I could read each and every one of your names individually, I'm letting you know that I would definitely do that.
Let me tell you.
It would take maybe about two or three shows to read everybody's name.
It was so many. See, it's something about that evil face that you were given sitting up on that stand. I know. We want you on our stand.
Right.
We want you on our stand.
Right.
Okay, because I'm trying to tell you, you guys got to go on Facebook and check out the picture that Kevin posted of him and Wendy. Man, the looks that they were given was right on point with how we were saying in the beginning of the show, you got to make it realistic.
Yeah. And you have to
make it realistic.
You know what? Here was my thinking, because I had that look on my face like that would say something along the lines, now you know you're lying.
Yeah.
I had that look.
Yeah.
Or I don't believe a word you're saying.
Exactly.
That expression, that was the expression. But here's my...
You and Wendy had and Wendy, the same yeah,
Wendy,
expression.
Wendy had that look like... Girl, if you don't
everybody know else was just sitting there looking, but you and Wendy had such the look on your face that the I don't recall if I think they do it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, they lawyers go over to the witness stand. They do that
sometimes.
Right?
Yeah.
Okay, she came over
to where I was,
put her hand on the thing where Kev was, and was talking directly to him because he was giving her what she needed.
Right, and let me say something. Let me tell you what else I gave her before the scene started. When they were going through the rehearsal,
and this
is what I learned. I'm gonna share two things that might can help somebody in terms of a tip. When they were going through the read through, you know how they go through the read through in the rehearsal before they actually shoot.
Yeah.
And the lady who plays the lawyer, her real first name is Quincy.
Mm-hmm.
And y'all, if you saw the episode, she did a fantastic job.
She did.
She ripped a new one.
Tasha's character. Yes, she did.
She ripped a new one in Tasha's character.
But that's why we're not going to give it away. But that's why Meth won her on the team.
Right, I got you. But here's one of the pointers, and this is going to be so general and generic, but it works. After we did the rehearsal, you know, we're sitting on the witness stand and all this. So while I'm on the witness stand, I'm going through my progression as an actor and what my thoughts would be.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'm not waiting until they get ready to film it to get into the character.
Right,
so I'm
right.
into the
You're
character.
Already there.
Into
yeah,
the character.
Yeah.
So I'm going to get to that second. After she did such a fantastic job and then she sat down and they were getting ready to shoot it, I clapped for her and said, Quincy, you did a fantastic job.
Mm-hmm.
And I believe that she reciprocated by helping me get more screen time
mm-hmm.
by walking over to where I was,
yep.
putting her hand on that thing,
and talking
directly to me.
You. And that's what she did.
And you know what I learned? Saying, giving someone a compliment genuinely goes a long way.
It does.
She helped me get extra screen time.
Yeah.
Not that the first part wasn't bad. That was
right.
great.
Yeah.
But she got me extra screen time. She didn't have to walk over and directly interact with me.
She did a fabulous job.
I didn't call her by her character. I called her by her real name.
Exactly.
And I think she appreciated that. That's just my rendition. Maybe she planned to do that. I don't know. I'm just.
I would have done it. I would have done it.
Really? If somebody, because, you know, encouraged you in that way.
Yeah, I would have done that because what she did,
mm-hmm.
what she did made it seem so real. You forgot that you were watching it on television. You forgot that they were acting and you were like actually there. Because I'm sitting there like, damn.
Yeah.
If this was real, she would be going to jail.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, absolutely.
If this was real, the way she did it and the way she interacted with you,
mm-hmm.
if that was a real case,
mm-hmm.
she would have been going to jail.
Right.
She would have been going to jail.
Now here's part two. Part two of that is... Once again, like I said, even when they were going through the rehearsal,
mm-hmm.
I was focused. You know what I mean? I was going through my progressions just as an actor. You see what I'm saying? No matter what role you play, you go through your progressions as an actor. You get into the thoughts.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And so I was getting into my character as they were going through the rehearsal. When it was time to shoot, I was already in my character.
Yeah.
I already had my thoughts lined up.
Yeah.
And it came out on my face. I didn't know what my face looked like till I saw it on TV.
Mm-hmm.
And this is what I learned. I'm thankful to God that I have the title that I'm a multi-award winning best film actor.
Mm-hmm.
I'm a multi-award winning best film actor no matter what role I'm playing.
Right.
No matter what role I'm playing.
And that's it.
And you're going to play your role no matter how big, medium, or small. You're going to play it like a multi-award winning best film
actor. And you have to, because you don't know what doors can open up for you just from that right there.
Absolutely.
You don't know. And you don't know who will remember you.
Yeah.
You know, you, well, wait a minute. Let me get that. Remember that guy who was on the jewelry stand, who was giving me the looks and stuff? Let's call, what's his name?
Right,
you know
him,
what I mean? Contact the casting agency, find out what his name is, and we need you. You never know who's watching. You never know what position God will put you in for somebody to hook you up. So you always want to make sure that whatever you're doing in front of that camera, good camera, that you're doing it to the best of God's ability, because you never know what line he has set you up in for people to come back and get you, for them to bless you. You never know. So you gotta, you have to do your best at all times. And if you're going to say thank you, say thank you. It goes a long way. You don't know who you're singing. You could be saying thank you to just a Joe Snowblow who you think is on the street. But that person turned out to be a multi-million dollar director, and he's just on the street doing commentary like the way you said thank you. Now he want to, hey, come back. So you never know. Kindness, professionalism, all that goes a long way.
Absolutely.
So you always want to be on it.
And I'm going to tell you, the way, because of course I was sitting in what would be considered juror number one seat. When they started that pan, it was a slow pan on me. I got at least about maybe 3, 4, 5 seconds of screen time as he slow panned past me. And it really, really caught my reaction. And now that I think back, when we were filming it, you know how you could tell when the camera's on you because you start swallowing your spit? You know, you feel like somebody's staring at you. I knew, but I did not know. You know, just like when we were on Guy Friended Me, how you could be sitting right in that camera. You don't know if it's going wide or you don't know if it's going straight. So, you know, you film stuff, you take it all in stride, you know, you wait till it comes out and you see what the cut. So, you know, I'm on my way home in the morning. My cousin Percy, man, he texted me all these pictures. Like, yo, you were just on Power. I forgot all about it because I filmed it a year and a half ago. I forgot all about it. You know, we film stuff. You move on to the next project. And then when it comes out, you see if you made the cut. And you keep it moving. You know what I mean? And he texted me the picture. And I was like, wow. Like, I took up half the TV screen when he started that painting. If you give the directors what they want,
They'll use it.
Yeah, man. So I just want to reiterate, thank you to everybody. Man, I love y'all guys. Thank you so much for all the love and support and outpouring and sharing and comments and messages and text messages and calls. We had our friends from Jason Letter call all the way from Canada.
Guarda called.
And just say congratulations and stuff. So it was just so overwhelming, man. I was so humbled by it. And so thankful and grateful to have gotten the screen time. That's it.
And on another note, thank you guys so much. While y'all was checking out Kev on Power Ghost Book 2, thank y'all so much for the birthday love. Oh, my God. It's just like the floodgates open up for you and that power. The floodgates open up for me, too. I'm still responding. I'm still responding to 5 days later, Kev. I'm still responding. To people who have said happy birthday. I got inboxed. I mean, if it was on Facebook, it was on Twitter, Instagram. I mean, thank y'all so much. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Patrice Hawthorne saying happy birthday to me. Saeed saying happy birthday. Thank y'all so much. I mean, we were like the featured people.
We were
the featured people. You on Power, me and my birthday. I mean, thank you so much, you guys, for the love that you have shown us, the love that you have shown our show. Thank you. Thank you, our acting. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you from the bottom of our heart. We thank you, man. I'm telling you.
Miss Mary sending us that jam.
Miss Mary sent us some jam.
You know what I'm saying?
And she sent us some different kind of jam, too. Man, I'm telling you right now, y'all make this little 25-year-old girl just feel so special. You better not say
that. And then we had a cast get together, and we broke out with two birthday cakes for you.
Two? Oh, my. Listen. You guys, I've seen one birthday cake. I had 2 birthday cakes, a whole bunch of pizza, and Pepsi.
That's it. That was it, man.
Man, and end up leaving my birthday card. I got to go back and get it. Yeah. But I'm trying to tell you, it's so much cake left over. So much love on my birthday. Shout out to Deborah Lamb, all the way from Cali, made the phone call. I was like, we got to do something. You know, thank you guys so much. Thank you guys so much. It was so much love going on.
Yes, it was.
I'm telling you, it was so much love. Thank you.
Yeah.
And the love that you all shown Kev in his performance on Power. I'm trying to tell you, if you have not seen it, you gotta go check it out, because this is where actors, okay, who said that? This is where
actors are made.
Actors are made.
Terrence Hakim.
Listen,
Jason Letter.
Him and Wendy was giving them what they asked for.
Yeah.
I'm trying to tell you. And if you don't know, now you know.
That's it.
Baby!
That's it, man.
You can play it back to your heart's content. It was good.
Yeah.
And it made you say, oh, darn it, they need to go back to court because you want to see some more. I'm trying to tell you, it was good. The looks that they were given, very good. Yeah. Very good. Yeah. Very good. But shout out to the entire cast, everybody. Very good.
Yeah, man. It was great. It was great. Just a
great,
you know, weekend, you know, just full of just great stuff. And
just a lot of fun.
You know, it's those moments, you know, like that. Where it just makes life better.
Yeah.
You know, it makes life better with all the negativity going on.
Mm-hmm.
It's just really, really good to be able to focus on something good and positive and fun that's surrounding support and encouragement, motivation, inspiration, and love. And that's what it's all about, man. That's what we're trying to bring you guys on the Kevin and Nikee Show. Yeah, man.
Yeah.
People all over the world, everybody. Join hands.
Join hands.
Getting on the love train.
People all over the world.
Everybody.
Join us.
We got on the love train.
Love train. Yes.
All right. All right.
My goodness. I want to play that song so bad now. You see what you did? I love that song.
The OJ.
Take these chains. Keep on riding for you. Wow. People all over the world. Love train. Yes.
All right, you know what?
Our special guests like that song too. So we're gonna play
at the end of the show.
Oh my goodness.
We playing
out. See what you did. Why you do that?
No.
Why you make me sing it if we ain't gonna play it?
No, we already sang it. Yeah. All right. But anyway. Alright, so we're gonna tell them where they can find
us. Go ahead.
Alright, guys. So listen, we want you guys to continue to just flow with us, grow with us, continue to follow our journey. We're gonna start out on YouTube. Check out Actor Kevin D. Ben, Actress Nikki Warren. Subscribe, we'll subscribe back. Listen, we got short films, we got feature films on there, commercials, we got monologues. Check out the multi-award winning The News, starring the girl to my right here.
Yeah.
And we are in a film festival that we're going to be telling you guys about, the Indo-American Festival, World Cinema. And it's going to be premiering in November, The News and Honor, on Amazon Fire Stick. So we're going to be telling y'all, so y'all can check it out. We'll bring you more about that. But for now, you can even watch it on YouTube.
That's right.
Right now, Honor and The News, Actor Kevin D. Ben, Actress Nikki Warren. Then on while you're on YouTube, check out the Recession web series. Multi-award winning writer, director, extraordinaire. He's a rapper, musician. He's doing his thing, man. Mr. Maurice Paramore and the Recession web series, getting a lot of attention, getting a lot of hits and clicks. Check it out. And then while you're on YouTube, we want you to check out Old Head, the series. And you can also check it out on Amazon Prime. While you're on Amazon Prime, check out Single and Anxious. They got season 1, 2, and 3. A lot of lies, lust, and love. I'm in season 3. You're going to really, really check it out. See how it all unfolds. Then while you're on Amazon Prime, check out the Right Path movie. Your girl is over here wielding M16. And then while we was at Shamar's wedding, she was talking to some executive producers, putting in her bid to start throwing some grenades and stuff.
That's
She might get cast for that. I don't know.
That's right.
We'll keep y'all posted about that. But check out the Recession web series, Old Head, the series. The Right Path movie, and then Single and Anxious, and then check out Revelation Blue, a good cop thriller. What do you do when you're torn between faith and the world? What decisions are you making? Check out the Recession web series. Mm-hmm. It's on there, man. It's really, really, when I say Recession, oh, Revelation Blue, I'm sorry. Check out Revelation Blue. It's really, really good. Then, look, head on over to, oh, no, you're going to stay on Amazon. Check out Mercy. You know what I'm saying? A lot of relevant issues going on in the community with the killing of unarmed African-American black men. Mm-hmm. And it's going to speak to it. But what do you do when you're in a position to take revenge or show mercy? Check out Mercy and see how it all unfolds. Then check out The Covington Witches, man. Halloween is coming up. You're going to want to check this out. You want to get in the mood to watch some something scary, spells and all that stuff. Check out actress Nikee Warren in The Recession. And what is it? The Covington Witches. It's really, really good, man. They really trying to resolve their problems and cast spells along the way. Check it out. Then check out the Peace series on YouTube. The girl over here plays the mama of the lead actress. He's a rapper trying to survive through the perils of South Philadelphia and make it big. And she's just trying to give him the guidance that he needs to survive.
Yep.
And she pulled it off big time. So check out that as well. Then head over to the Stars Network. You can check out Power, Book 2. Ghosts. They got episode 1, 2. As we just told you, I'm in season 3. And then while you're on Star, check out Jason's Letter. You can catch us on that doing our parenting skills or traditional parenting skills in the mm-hmm. detention scene, handling our children like they're supposed to be handled. You know what I mean? Y'all know how it was back in the day when the village raised your children.
How about that?
You know what I'm saying? How about so this? You can check us out on Jason's Letter. Check it out. So I think I did
That's
everything.
It. You got
I think,
everything.
I think I did everything.
Yep, you did.
All right.
All right.
All right.
All right.
So we're going to take a break?
Yep. We're going to take a break. But before we do, man, listen.
We have a special guest in the house. He is a super talented actor. He can be seen in some of the biggest titles on TV and in theaters. And he is in one of the hottest new movies out. Y'all gonna know what it is. Big budget, big time actors doing big things. And hey, they bring an honor to their family along the way. We don't want to tell you what that big time movie is and who he is. But listen, y'all gonna really, really enjoy his journey. And all the songs that you will hear on today's show will come from the movie Mulan and the cartoon Mulan soundtrack. In honor of our special guest. So don't touch that dial, man. Don't go nowhere. It's the Kevin and Nikki Show on iHeartRadio. We everywhere and we will
be right back.
War is not freedom. Over my shoulder, I see a clear view. All for my family, reason I'm breathing, everything to lose. Should I ask myself in the water what a warrior would do? Tell me. Am I loyal, brave, and true? Am I loyal, brave, and true? Losing is easy. Winning takes bravery. I am a tiger's fool. Out in the open, no one to save me. The kindest of whispers are cool. Should I ask myself in the water what a warrior would do? Tell me underneath my armor, am I loyal, brave, and true? Am I loyal, brave, and true? Cold is the morning, warm is the tree. to be loyal, brave, and true.
Satisfy your sweet tooth with some tasty treats from the Brownie Shop. Fudge cupcakes, sweet potato pie, freshly baked bread, homemade ice cream, creamy chocolatey brownies, and much, much more. Check out their full menu on Facebook Brownie Shop or Brownie Shop 2019 Instagram. Get your next dessert from the Brownie Shop. Your sweet tooth will love you for it.
Urban Elite Beauty LLC is an online urban beauty supply store that serves both men and women in urban communities. Our goal is to provide quality beauty solutions for our culture and community. Most importantly, we want to instill in our friends the importance of loving thy hair, loving thy skin, and to love thyself. Check us out on social media, on Facebook at Urban Elite Beauty, on Twitter at DBenton71, on Instagram at Urban_Elite_Beauty, and for more information, go to our website at www.urbanelitebeauty.com or email founder and CEO David Benton at dbenton@urbanelitebeauty.com or call 609-217-5292. Check us out and see what the Urban Elite Beauty experience is all about.
Yes, all right. I love that song.
Yeah.
Yes.
That's Mulan.
Loyal, Brave, and True, the movie.
The movie.
Yes.
That's it right there.
I love that song. And I like the fact that they brought Christina Aguilera back to sing on this soundtrack because she knows she sang the other one.
Right.
Yes.
And I thought that that was a very fitting song that you picked to bring
out our special guest.
You know what I'm saying?
And I love you, brave and true. I love it. Christina has that voice.
Yeah.
She just has that voice, and I am so...
I know she was hitting on notes up and down.
And I love, like I said, I love the fact that they brought her back to sing, you know, on the soundtrack for this one, because she sang on the soundtrack for the last one.
Yeah.
Such a beautiful voice.
Yeah,
and her, you want to hear a backstory? Christina Aguilera, her backstory will have you move the tears.
Oh, yeah, I heard she was, like, bullied.
She was bullied in school. And when she came out with this song, her very first song she came out with and people heard her on the radio, that's when they started to treat her differently.
Yeah. It's funny how success makes people treat you differently.
Yep. That's when they started to treat her differently. She was bullied. She said she was bullied very badly in school. Very badly. Mm-hmm. Every day, she said it was a battle. Mm-hmm. Every day. And now look at her.
Man, I just find that to be amazing that she took that painful... part of her life, and evidently she had to turn it into propelling her towards success. Yeah. She's one of the greatest, you know, singers of our generation.
Yes,
and of our time.
Yeah, absolutely. She got this one song, "Beautiful." I am beautiful, no matter what people say. Words can bring me down. I love that song.
Mm-hmm.
Love it.
You know what? And that's evidence. That song is evidence that sometimes it's going to be your painful story that bring forth something positive like that.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Now, Taylor Swift, she's working it backwards. When she break up, she got to make a song. She got to make a song about every boyfriend. So. People don't want to date her because they don't want no song made about her. But that's another story. Anyway.
Taylor alone. Yeah. Yes.
All right. So, are we ready for our special guest?
Yep. We are ready. Listen, our special guest has an international background that instilled in him early a lifelong love and curiosity for different cultures, people, and experiences. As a Chinese citizen and United States permanent resident and fluent in both Mandarin and English, he has been able to bridge a gap between both Hollywood and China during his career.
Our special guest has acted in numerous films and television series, most recently as Zhao in the much-anticipated Disney live-action remake of Mulan.
Yeah.
2020, directed by Nikee Caro, and as the main cast member, Hong, on the Bruce Lee-inspired Cinemax show, Warrior 219, from Jonathan Trooper and Justin Lin. We know Justin Lin from Fast and Furious. That's right, director of Fast and Furious. So other reoccurring credits include Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. 2013, Bosch, 2014, Grey's Anatomy, 2005, and Being Mary Jane, 2013, among many, many others.
Yes. Our special guest, born in Kobe, Japan, and spent most of his childhood in Guangxi, China, our special guest belongs to the ethnic minority Zhuang group from southern China. His parents were trained as medical doctors in China and among the first government-sponsored international student to leave the mainland during the reopening of China in the 1980s. His parents lived in Japan for almost 6 years, during which our special guest was raised by his grandparents back in China while they pursued their doctorates there. After immigrating to the United States, his family settled in the deep south of Memphis, Tennessee, not knowing anything different. His first accent in English was a natural southern accent. Oh, I gotta hear that. Natural southern accent. Mm-hmm. Was a natural southern accent, mm-hmm. which for some reason always surprised people to hear. Though he always stayed connected to his Chinese roots and often revisited China, he still feels very much rooted to the southern culture that he grew up in.
Our special guest has great respect for the men and women in the armed forces, no matter the country. Coming from a military family, his grandfather and several relatives serving in the Chinese People's Liberation Army. He once had aspirations of being a soldier, but soon falling in love with acting instead, he went off to Boston and then later New York City to pursue his craft. Sporadic work began to come his way on the New York stage in television and independent films, and he eventually made the move to Los Angeles to pursue his passion in front of the camera. Perhaps due to his varied travels and background, our special guest has consistently been noted for a rare Chameleon-like ability to transform in his work, resulting in many roles that appear, sound, and feel very distinct from each other. They call that versatility.
Mm-hmm.
And we have him on the Kevin and Nikki show today.
Yes.
Now, who are we talking about?
None other than
Mr. Chen Ying Tang.
Woo!
Right, how you doing, Mr.
Yes.
Chang?
I'm good, Kevin. How are you, man?
Doing well.
Yes.
Yeah, doing very, very well. Yeah, we are so honored to have you on our show, and we always like to start by saying thank you so much mm-hmm. for taking time out of your busy schedule. We know you got a lot going on, but you stopped by the Kevin and Nikki show to share with us and our listeners
yes.
around the world, and we are happy about that.
Yes.
So thank you, sir.
Yeah, you received and thank you right back.
Yes.
Well, look,
we're going to jump right on into it because you were in one of my favorite movies, Mulan. I love that movie, going from the cartoon all the way to the movie. My favorite song is "Be a Man, Gonna Make a Man Out of You."
No pressure, right? No pressure.
Listen, I love that song. I be singing all the time. Kevin, like, why you sound like that? Because right. that's the way it goes. I love it.
Right.
So I want to go back to the beginning. Tell our listeners a little bit about how you got started acting. Like, what made you fall in love with acting?
Well, you know, I kind of got into this thing sort of late. I'm kind of a late bloomer in a way. And I didn't really get into acting until I was about 19. A little bit background about me. I'm actually from Memphis, Tennessee.
Mm-hmm.
I'm from China, but I grew up in Memphis, Tennessee.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And, you know, back then, we're from the inner city. So, like, I wouldn't really have any kind of, like, connection with, like, the entertainment industry or anything. I actually wanted to be a soldier.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, when I was going off college, you know, it was about 2006. And when my mom was like, you know, you can be a soldier, but just know that you would get sent right to Iraq right now. Just entered this war.
Wow.
All right. So I went off to University of Miami, the U, and I was studying business at the time. Didn't know what I was wanting to do, but we had to take a fine arts class.
Mm-hmm.
And I just chose acting. I thought that was kind of fun. I thought it would be kind of enjoyable. And, you know, just while I was doing it, the teacher was just like, you know, you're pretty good at this. Like, you seem to really enjoy this. And why don't you audition for some of our shows?
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, I got a monologue together. I went to audition and I actually got in. I was over there doing a musical. That was my first show.
Wow.
And And I, when I was, I realized, like, during the process, I was like, wow, this is not even, this is work. People get paid for this?
Right.
I'm just enjoying myself. I'm just truly enjoying it. And it's the whole process. And it's also, I fell in love with the fact that, you know, this is a craft. And this is something that I can really give my life to and really master in a way as best I can. Mm-hmm. And so when I realized, I think it was like one day in the middle of my dorm room, I woke up, looked at the ceiling, and I just said, you know what? God, universe, I think I'm going to be a professional actor. That's what I'm going to do. Mm-hmm. And I just decided to like give my life to it. And it was just a decision. It wasn't anything like crazy and dramatic, like the muses did not come down from the heavens and like, anoint me as an actor. I was just like, I just found something I truly enjoyed, and that I decided to transfer schools. I went to Emerson College in Boston, and I started studying acting and just started doing it, you know, auditioning professionally, and I just started off from there and went to New York, and then the last 6 years I've been here in LA, you know, just pursuing my dreams, you know.
Yeah, that's nice, man. You know, it's always fascinating to hear, you know, how people got started in their craft, rather be acting, writing, directing. And it's kind of like when you hear them telling this story, it's almost like that kid in the candy store. You know, it's kind of like reliving, you know.
Oh, you can hear it.
Yeah, I can hear it, man. That positive passion. But that is just so awesome, man. And, You're very, very talented. We like to classify it as super talented. You've been in some awesome films.
Very kind.
You've been in some awesome films. And one of my favorites as well as Nikki's favorites, you know, the remake of Mulan.
Love it.
We both saw the movie. Fantastic movie.
Love it.
I mean, the acting was phenomenal. The costumes was phenomenal. The sets were phenomenal. And it was just a great movie. But one of the things that we liked about it is that it has some messages in there for the world, one of which, bringing honor to your family and friends. How did that message resonate with you? Because I know in Asian culture from living over there, they big on family. Like, family is a big thing, man. And it's about not wanting to dishonor your family, but bring honor to your family. And that was a theme in Mulan. But how did the movie and that theme particularly resonate with you?
You know what? Because I'm truly bicultural. You know, I grew up in China during my childhood, and I went back all the time. So I'm still so connected to my Chinese roots. And one of the things that I think a lot of people may not fully understand, unless you come from a culture of like that sense of honor, you know, it's just it's not just a word. And for us, it's you know, in Chinese, it's called 孝道. It's literally like there is a word for filial piety. You know, this is for your family. Everything is for your family. And it's so ingrained in our bones that it goes just beyond just honoring your family. This honor word, in many ways, is like, in our culture, it's such a big emphasis on being together. It's a community. It's not an individualistic culture.
Right.
I mean, it just by history and culture and just by our roots, because I find that that one of the biggest things that people kind of misunderstand is just about that word honor. It's not so much as like for yourself, it comes from this place of deep, deep love where in a way your family, your parents especially, have given everything, like their flesh and blood and all of their life for you.
Right.
And because of that, it is your duty and your responsibility. To take care of them, you know, as they get older. They took care of you when you were younger, and your job is to take care of them when they get older. And that right there, I'm like, I get chill bumps when I talk about that, because it's not just honor. That's more like, it's literally more like, you know, this is your life. This is you are a part of them, and we are a family. And in many ways that bleeds through for the entire culture.
So for me, it
was a very deep thing, you know, because I can instantaneously, every Chinese, you know, kid that reads Mulan, the Ballad of Hua Mulan, they know instantaneously why she would go and do anything and move heaven and earth.
Right.
Nice.
Because she doesn't want to see her father not only, you know, be hurt or possibly killed, she doesn't want him to even have to think about losing faith and not being able to serve his duty.
Right. Yeah. Right.
Nice.
That's very powerful.
He gets a bell. Yeah. That's very powerful.
Yeah, that was powerful. Love that it. Was very, love very it. Powerful. Love and, it. You know, as you were explaining it, it took me to the deeper root of mm-hmm. what it meant.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? And I just kind of wish that was a heart set. I was getting ready to say philosophy, but it's not a philosophy. It's a heart set and a mindset and a way of being and a way of living. I wish that the kids of this generation could grab hold of that, especially here in America.
Yeah, they don't know about that.
You know what I mean? Because, I knew, you know, me and Nikki, we talked about this on a previous show. We grew up with a sense of not wanting to disappoint our mm-hmm. families.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? And it helped that dad sat by the door and told us, okay, y'all going out to play. Y'all better not let nothing bad come back to that mm-hmm. door. So that helped too, but you know, we grew up with this.
That helped in the switch outside on a tree. That helped too.
The spankings.
The spankings.
Well, you know what? Like, Kevin and Nikki, you gotta see where the deep roots of that not wanting to disappoint people comes from. I mean, this is inherent in all of us. You know, that actually comes from a place of love. It all comes from love.
Right. Yeah.
Because when you love someone or something, you're focused externally and you're not thinking about yourself.
That person,
you would do anything if it means something to you.
Yeah.
You would do anything to help that person.
Yeah.
And actually, you know, some of my closest friends, they are single parents, single mom, mm-hmm. you know. And they tell me honestly, they're like, you know, I never knew how strong I could be.
Mm-hmm.
Until I had nothing else but to be strong to take care of this life.
Yeah.
Because see, they're not focused on their internal. They're focusing external. They're focusing on this person that they have to take care of. And you can do many mighty things because of that love for someone else, not just for yourself.
Right.
And in a way, when you love someone else, you are loving yourself. Aren't
yeah,
you?
Absolutely.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah,
that's very, very powerful, man. Very, very,
very powerful.
And
we kind of went down a deep rabbit hole here.
No, that's okay.
No,
listen,
we love it.
We one of the things that we do, we're gonna talk about, you know, what's passionate mm-hmm. for our guests.
Yep.
So if the direction of the conversation goes in that direction, then that's the way it was supposed to go. But I appreciate you sharing this because it's so important.
Mm-hmm.
It's very, very important. And it's something that's lost, particularly in our culture, I can say.
Yeah.
You know, you have kids that are out here making knucklehead decisions, only thinking about themselves. And then mom has to come down to mm-hmm. get them out to youth mm-hmm. study center. Or, you know, she's got to take a day off from work to, you know, go to their court hearing. Mm-hmm. And they're only thinking about themselves. And they're not concerned about the fact that mom is sitting over there crying. Because the child that she brought into this world, she didn't envision them going to jail or being a criminal or flunking out of school. And, you know, it's like our generation of young people, particularly in this country, they've lost that. You know, they really, really lost that since our generation, because we live with a sense of wanting to make our parents proud. And we still have it. We still live with it. That's why we have passion and drivenness about even acting, because we want mom and dad to walk the red carpet and be the celebrities that they deserve to be, not only because they gave birth to us, but they invested in us, and we wouldn't be where we are without them. And so everybody doesn't have that concept. So I appreciate you, you know, going down that rabbit hole and sharing it. If you have anything else you want to add to it, you keep going.
Absolutely.
Because we're going to follow you, man.
That's right. Because one of my favorite parts in the movie is where it is towards the end when they gave her the sword.
Yeah.
And it had loyal, brave, and true on it. And then she turned it over. They told her to turn it over. And it was another word on the back, which is something that meant, you know, it was very deeply to her.
Right.
So my question to you is, how did you get cast in this movie?
Oh, how did I get cast?
Yeah, because you play Yao. So how did you get cast as Yao in this movie?
You know, it's always a running joke when we were down there shooting and afterwards, because Listen, I don't look like a cartoon character. Let's just get that out of the way. It was always a big joke of like everybody, you know, they were strangers. They found out that we were shooting Mulan there and they met me and they're like, oh yeah, you play the captain, right?
But I mean the truth is
you know, during the casting process, this was a very long casting process for the course of the movie. I believe they spent over 3 or 4 years actually preparing to, you know, do all the pre-production. And in the casting process, we started shooting in middle of 2018. Mm-hmm. And they started casting this project somewhere around 2016. Oh, wow. They were just trying to find, I mean, like everybody here in LA, I'm pretty sure, I have no doubt that pretty much every Asian person in the city went out for this thing. They wanted to do this, you know. My process was pretty straightforward, mm-hmm. because when I started, it was, I think if you were the guy, you went out for the love interest. And if you were a girl of the right age, you went out for Mulan, right? They didn't have any other sides or any other themes available. And so, you know, I went in 2016, like everybody else, didn't hear anything back. And I actually had forgotten about it. Mm-hmm. I knew I did a great audition. I was like, for whatever reason, they didn't bring me back. Mm-hmm. And I had forgotten about it. And it was about maybe in April or May 2018.
Wow.
Like right before they were going to start shooting, I got another audition mm-hmm. for Mulan. And I was like, oh my God, they're still casting this. So the casting director, Deborah Zane, she brought me back here in LA, and she was like, during the audition, she was just like, hey, listen, here's the situation. Most of the cast is actually set, you know, but Disney felt like they were missing like this sort of machismo filled, like bully kind of like soldier mm-hmm. to bring into this, like this energy into the cast. And we remembered some of you guys from way back, mm-hmm. so wow. We wanted to bring you back and see what you do with it. And I immediately thought, I was like, you know, even from the audition, I had Yao in my mind, my okay. version of Yao, my essence. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And so I brought that, you know, and then it was literally in a span of 3 weeks that I did my callback for Nikee and the producers and everything. And then they confirmed me and they were like, get ready to go because you're about to leave in about a few weeks.
Oh, wow.
And so like I had probably one of the fastest casting processes. Some of the other guys in the cast, they literally started in 2016 mm-hmm. and they weren't confirmed until like spring of 2018. You know, imagine that as an actor going through that process.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well,
so I got pretty lucky I felt like, you know what? I still did my work, you know, and they remember me, thank God. But yeah. Nice. it was a quick whirlwind for me.
Right. Nice.
And let me tell you, like I said, the acting was fantastic. You did a fantastic job. I mean, you was wielding that bow and arrow, man. You know what I mean? you did a fantastic job, man. And you know, some of the characters in there who I'm familiar with. Of course, you had. I mean, I hope I don't hack up these names. Of course, we got Jason Scott Lee. Then we had TJ Ma from Rush Hour. He played the dad. He was fantastic. Mm-hmm. Then we had Li Yafei, the one who played Mulan. I remember her from Forbidden Kingdom with Jackie Chan. She played Sparrow.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
And,
I'm gonna tell you,
she doesn't age a bit. She still looks the same.
No, but, she doesn't.
Yeah.
No, she doesn't.
Yeah, she does.
That's
not age.
Discount, guys.
Absolutely, man. And then, of course, you know, Donnie Yen. I'm a martial arts fan. Yes. Donnie Yen, the legend, the icon, man. He's just great. Everybody did a fantastic job. I kind of hate calling names because you leave out somebody that did a great job. So whereas me and Nikki say, lottie dottie,
everybody
did a great job.
Yes. Everybody did a fabulous job. I ain't going to say no names, but somebody.
And Chen did a great job too, man. Yes. I'm telling you, he had that bow and arrow, man. Yes. He was letting it fly.
I ain't going to say no names, but somebody watched that movie like 4 times.
Who watched it? It was great. It was a really, really good movie. It was a great movie, man. And this, it was just pleasing to watch, to learn, to get the, you know, the messages.
Yeah.
And of course, if you were a fan of the cartoons and things like that, you automatically was a fan of it. And, but my question is, how did you like prepare for your character? Like what mindset did you have to get into? What was your thinking? You know, did the bow and arrow help bring a little aggression?
Well, you know what? One of the things that I did with Yao was, I took a lot of inspiration from the cartoon.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he's sort of this gruff. I had to first off accept the fact that I'm not 5 feet tall and I'm not middle aged.
Mm-hmm.
But I really felt like, you know, I loved so much of the cartoon, and he's one of my favorite characters in the cartoon.
Yeah.
So I really just sort of stole / borrowed from, you know, a lot of that essence. But Nikki Carroll, the director, she basically said to us, you know what? Don't worry about trying to be so faithful, because we want to make it you. Don't be him, be you.
Right.
And but, you know, feel free to take because it's like artistic, you know, your artistic choice.
Mm-hmm.
But what I did was, you know, to try to make it my own, I really I actually drew a lot from my own cultural background.
Okay.
Of being from this particular part of China. This part of China is like literally my hometown is from very close to the Vietnam border. It's in the deep south of China.
Okay.
And it is a place of like these rolling green hills, mountains like of stone. I mean, like it looks like a sort of a jungle in a way.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought to myself, you know, if I'm the king of the rock, I'm the king of the mountain, and I'm back then in this time period. In that time period, you have to understand that part of China was full of, like, our people are actually a minority group in China. And we were known to be just this fierce, like, sort of wild mountain people. And so I was like, this is perfect. I'm going to bring this culture, this part in. And nobody has to know about it, but I know that in my heart, Yao is from the deep south of China, from this fierce bunch of people who are just very machismo filled, you know?
Right.
And so I brought that. And I also, we spent a lot of time working the physical life of the character. We had a boot camp. They threw us right into a boot camp to get that, to not only feel and look like farmer, laborer, soldiers, like you've been doing physical labor your whole life, but also to get that camaraderie between us. And then I actually, one of the things that I really never told anybody that I did in New Zealand was I had decided that I needed to feel like this masculinity, especially through my arms and my hands. I mean, that's the best way I can describe it. It was through my body. Of like, you know, this is a guy who uses your hand. You use your hands all the time. And I thought, you know what? I'm a blacksmith. I was a blacksmith's son. And I'm going to find a blacksmith here in New Zealand.
Hmm.
And so that's what I did. I actually found, and it so happened to be in Auckland, that there was the only, I believe it was the only traditional blacksmith shop in basically like in the Asia Pacific area. And there was this guy, and he was just like, you know, he was like working the fire. And I went up, you know, I came up to him and I was like, you know what? I would like to learn from you. I want to learn all about blacksmithing.
Wow.
And so we did lessons. I mean, I learned how to blacksmith. I learned how to like use the sledgehammer. You learn how to use the hammer and the anvil and like look at the fire and see just how hot it is. Like I made like knives. And I'm telling you, there's something about doing that physically, man. As soon as I smelled the coals, I just dropped right into this, like, man, you know?
Like you was in the zone, man.
Wow.
And it's something physical like that that I brought. And I was like, I never had to tell anybody about it, but I knew that I just could throw my weight around. You know, I'm used to, like, using a hammer and you know, and I felt like that really colored the way I looked at the world and moved around the world, you know, be a bull in a china shop in a way. So that was in a long-winded answer, that's sort of how I started that preparation process.
But you know, that is great, man, because we hear stories in acting, Jake Gyllenhaal when he did The Boxer, threw himself in jail for 6 months. You know, it's really fascinating to see the professional research that actors do or what they may subject themselves or expose themselves to better perfect their characters. I'm going to tell you, you might have been Mulan's sidekick, but you really carved out your niche. You really carved out your niche and kind of had your own, you know, you were your, you created like your own character. You know, when you think of a sidekick, it's okay, there's Mulan, there's Yao. But you really had your own persona. And to hear the backstory of how you developed that and where it came from, I think that was very, very fascinating, man. And it's so.
I think that's our job. You know?
Yeah, that's right.
That's You know, that's it's a joyful process for me personally to just like really start discovering like another person's life, really living their skin in a way, and you find out so much about yourself. You know, and because I have a big belief that I believe in the malleability of the human spirit and mind. And what I mean by that is, see, if I plucked you up, either of you, and I dropped you in, say, China, and that's where you lived for, you know, growing up, you would see the world as a Chinese person.
That's right. Like,
it's just based on, you know, whatever your experiences are. And what people, and that's why I hate the word, like, you know, when people say to you, oh, just be yourself. I'm like, well, yourself in what situation?
Right.
With what circumstances? Yourself talking to who? How are you feeling that day?
Right.
You can be any which way you want. And that's, for me, that's that beginner's mind of whenever I explore a character's life, that's where I start. Because I'm like, well, how could I, if I was in this circumstance, what would I be like? And you start living with that for a while. I swear, it's just something happens. You change cellularly in a way.
Yeah. And that's we reiterate that, you know, on the show. You know, how would I think, feel, believe, and behave in this particular situation?
Make it real.
You know, me and Nikki,
make it real.
We were talking about the scene in Bad Boys 3 when the dead body dropped from the hotel on top of the car. And some of the people were walking by and they didn't turn their head to look at it or put your hand over your mouth and say, oh my God, nobody ran. I'm sitting over here like, okay. Now, that wasn't real.
Maybe this happens really often.
No.
That's right.
Maybe
man.
This happens really often.
Yeah, I got it. That's right. Yeah.
Now, how often do you see a dead body dropping on cars that you're just not, you know, in tune to?
Yeah, and affected by it.
Yeah, you're not affected by it. That's just crazy. Nobody did anything. They just kept on walking. Nobody turned around. Nobody fell on the floor. Now, if that was me, I would have been all out in the street. Oh, my God.
Yeah. Well, you know what, Nikki? You think that. You think that. But you might not.
Really?
If that actually happened, you know, you would be surprised. You always think you know what you're going to do until it happens.
That's true.
Well, there's some people
they're like, they literally did not process that, you know?
That's
like,
true. That has happened.
You know?
I don't know. If I see something like that, I would pass out, you know, for real.
Yeah, but that is just so awesome. And, you know, when you think about some of the iconic characters, you know, when I think about Superman, I actually think about Christopher Reeve in my generation before you get to the Brandon Roths and things like that. But when I went to see Superman Returns and watching Brandon Roth, you're really not watching him to be Christopher Reeve. You're maybe watching him to pay respects to Christopher Reeve. You want to see the character Brandon Roth pay respects to the traditional Superman and that of Christopher Reeve, but you want to see him make it his own. And there was a particular scene when Brandon Roth was in outer space, and the kind of the way he threw his hands eloquently, like he was doing ballet out to the side, I said, wow, that's unique. That's, you know, that's his spin on it. And you really put your spin on Yao that made it your own. And once again, man, you know, you did a fantastic job.
You ought
to be proud, man. And we saw the pictures of you guys at the premiere. You guys were just having such a blast, and y'all looked fabulous.
Yeah.
And y'all had such a great, it looked like y'all were just having a great time. Talk a little bit about that experience, man, because y'all were smiling from ear to ear, man.
Well, yeah, you know, it's what can I say? It's I believe that's like a Hollywood dream come true,
yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
And what made it even more fun for me was being able to bring my family from Memphis.
Yeah.
To come with me.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, they could see, you know, their baby boy on the red carpet.
Yeah,
and
that's the
like,
best part.
I mean, literally, you know, I had been on red carpet before, but nothing on, like, that scale.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's just like they, you know, it's like you imagine. It was like, you go in, it's like click, 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 click,
mm-hmm,
you know?
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, blinded by flashing lights in a way. And it was such a whirlwind. Anna could tell you she was there, you know? And for me, it was such an amazing first experience because honestly, you know, I just couldn't, and I felt this way throughout the entire process of shooting all the way up till through the premiere, and even now, you know, some days I wake up and I have to pinch myself,
yeah,
and I'm like,
yeah
is that really real?
Right.
I feel grateful. I feel more than anything. I feel extremely grateful.
Yeah, absolutely.
That's the best part when you take your family and they see you up there, and you know you see yourself up there and you cheesing and everything. That's me. I love it.
Love it. And if it catch you at the right time, man, you might even shed a tear that, you know, to be able to just look on that big screen and, you know, soak in that moment, the whole, you know, moment where,
mm-hmm,
hey, this is actually really, really happening. And if I'm dreaming, don't wake me up. You know what I'm saying? So it's fantastic,
yeah,
man. You already have been bringing honor to your family. You brought honor to China. You brought honor to the acting world, man. And you're doing a great job.
And you know what? I'm always saying, you know, putting on for my city. So, like, I always try to bring honor to Memphis.
That's right. We got to throw Memphis in there.
House.
That's it. Yeah, man. But
absolutely.
You know, I saw in your bio that, you know, you talked about how you know, of course, being Chinese, but you had a Southern accent. And I was like, it kind of reminded me, like, okay, how does that work? You know what I'm saying? But like you said, if you're placed in a certain environment.
You know, like I can turn it on and off like a waterfall. People think I'm faking, but like, you know, I grew up like 16 years in Memphis. And so when I'm back home, you know, back in the 901, it's like, That's how you just drop right into it.
He said you just drop right into it.
And then people, they're like, well, you know, well, you're faking. And I'm like, no, guys, you know what the problem is? You guys, or many people, have an assumption about the way
things are. It's making judgments.
Just making judgments. That's one of the greatest things that, you know, we all people of color here. We're all minorities. You know, one of the things that I believe people in general have about minorities is like, oh, you must be this way.
You know,
they see an image, but you know, like, you know what? Everybody's unique. Everybody's got a unique background. And just because you might not have seen it a lot does not mean it does not exist. I can tell you for a fact, like I know many people in the South who are of Asian descent, and some of them are like multiple generation, you know, they are just as Southern as they come.
And that's so interesting and so profound, and it brings out an excellent point about prejudices, making judgment, because like, you know, it's like with African Americans, they think every African American that's tall automatically plays basketball. And sometimes I was like, I play soccer, which I did in middle school, but I did play basketball, but I played soccer as well. You know what I'm saying? And that's like, you know, in Asian culture, they think everybody in Asian culture know how to do karate and martial arts. And that's not the case as well. You know what I'm saying? And
kind of see them as the human being they are.
That's right. And you know what? That would be a perfect Mulan-like theme. I like it.
Yeah.
But Chen, man, you have been a fabulous guest. We don't want to hold you no longer, man, because we know you got to go. But this was so much fun, man. We might have to do a part two. We want to give a shout out to Diana, shout out to Anna, and shout out to the whole cast and crew and production and director, Mulan. Continued success and blessings to you, man. And As we always say, once you come on the Kevin and Nikki show,
your family.
I appreciate it. Thank you so much. And you know what? I'd like to take this opportunity, if you guys get a chance. My show, I'm joining the second season of a TV show, and it's premiering this Friday, actually.
Okay.
Yeah, so if you get a chance, check out Warrior on Cinemax. And it's basically like...
It's the Bruce Lee story, right?
It's a Tarantino-esque fantasized version of 19th century Chinatown gang wars.
Oh, okay. Nice.
And
nice.
It's based off of a Bruce Lee story. Nice. So.
Yeah, and man, I'm going to tell you, I'm a big fan of Bruce Lee. I got my Bruce Lee accent down too, man. Like,
me too.
You know,
Have you seen our show?
Which one is that one?
Warrior.
I haven't seen Warrior. I saw the Dragon story, of course.
You got to see Warrior. I'm sorry. If you're a Bruce Lee fan, you got to see it.
I'm definitely checking it out. And I wish we could have kind of talked about it, but that's okay. We'll get you for part two, man. But, yeah, big Bruce Lee fan. Mm-hmm. Yes, I've seen just about all of his movies. And I like what he said when he started talking about his philosophy. He said, martial arts is not about doing you in.
So what I'm saying is...
So what I'm trying to explain to you is... Yeah, man. Bruce Lee was the man. You know what? And, you know, you talk about cross-cultural. I don't care what culture you came from. Everybody wanted to do... You know what I'm saying? I'm telling you, man.
I've done it a few times.
Yeah, I've done it a few times in my life, too.
Yes. Love it. Yeah, love absolutely.
So, yeah, if people want to follow
guys, thank you so much.
Oh, man, thank you so much, man. We're honored to have you. Yes. But if people want to follow you, you know, whether you want to put your IMDb out there, if you got a website, you know, take this opportunity, if you so desire, to put it out there so people can keep up with your career. Everybody definitely going to check out Warrior. But, you know, this is your time if you so desire.
Well, you know what? Just follow me on Instagram. My handle is at Chen Loves Y'all. YALL.
I like it.
Chen Loves Y'all. Love it.
Yeah. All right, sir. Well, continued success and blessings to you, man. And hopefully, man, maybe in the near future, we can get you on for a part two of this thing and come back and talk about Warrior and whatever else you got brewing on your agenda. And man, I'm just going to say, you know, we're proud of you, man, and honored to have you on the Kevin and Nikki show.
Oh, I feel it, man. Thank you so much, guys. It was an honor to be here.
Yeah. Yes, thank you for coming on our show.
Awesome. All right.
Well,
you guys have a good rest of your evening.
Yes.
And we will talk to you soon.
All right. Take care. Bye-bye.
All right. Bye. Man, what
awesome songs.
Shane loves y'all.
I like it.
I love it. Awesome.
That was awesome, man.
That was an awesome interview.
That was awesome. Yeah. You know, once again, I love it. The unscriptedness of the Kevin and Nikki show, where we allow our guests to talk about whatever's on their heart.
Yep.
And when he started talking about that, like he took it honor to a deeper level.
He did.
You know what I mean? It's just, he just took it to a deeper level, man. And it's like, I you know, we kind of grabbed that as he was explaining it. It's a heart thing. It's a mindset thing. It's a being thing.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Yeah. And
I like how you say everybody has it.
Everybody has it, but not everybody uses it. That's right. We're going to be honest. Not everybody uses it. Everybody has it, but they don't use it.
Yeah.
And that was one of the things, like I learned when, you know, when I was living over there for 2 years over in China, family was very important. In a lot of... you know, I guess I want to say family events or things like that centered around eating food.
Yep.
And, you know, of course, the way that they do it, like all the food comes to the center of the table.
Mm-hmm.
You get your, you know, your bowl,
your
shovel,
sticks.
Your chopsticks. And I'm going to say, I can eat with chopsticks better. I can eat with a fork and spoon.
I can do it just a little bit. Mm-hmm. I would have to take like a few tries. I'm not an expert in it, but... I can eat with chopsticks a little bit, but I can't pick up a whole lot of stuff.
Okay.
Maybe just one thing.
Okay, but it's the way you hold them in your hand. It depends on what, you know, the strength of how you
think it's the bottom stick that keep dropping out my hand.
Well, I'm going to have to show you. I'm going to give you a few lessons on how to eat.
Because you're talking about picking up an egg. I can just pick up one piece of egg. That's it.
If you hold it right and do it right, you could pick up a whole big piece of chicken with a chopstick.
I can't do that just yet. I'm still learning.
Well, we're going to help you out. So we already helping you out with your Chinese.
Yes.
Share the word that you learned. Shit. There you go. You're getting there. That's it. I'm getting there. Now say this. What? Say bukachi.
Bukachi.
What does that mean? You're welcome.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
Bukachi.
No, it's not bukachi.
Okay.
It's bukachi.
Bukachi.
That's it. It means you're welcome. That's it.
Bukachi.
So if you know thank you and you're welcome, say Michalo.
Michalo.
That means Bruce Lee.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Michalo.
Yeah, don't call nobody that.
No. Okay. Okay.
I asked this dude how you pronounce Bruce Lee in Chinese. He put his middle finger up there. Yeah, I was just trying to learn the words. So I wasn't trying to call him that.
No,
you know what I'm saying?
Get out of here.
I said, man, how do you say that? He thought I guess he thought I was trying to say him. But anyway. But yeah, it was a great interview, man.
Yes, it was.
You could hear the passion in Chen's voice as he talked about certain topics, and you knew it was near and dear to his heart, or he was reliving positive moments, man. And you know, you have experiences like that on a grand scale. That's Disney. It don't get no bigger than Disney.
It doesn't.
That's like the NBA championship, you know. Mm-hmm. You know, getting on a Disney platform like that. And Mulan was just a great movie.
It did
not disappoint.
Yeah.
I'm sure everybody had their own personal opinion about the movie. We thought it was fantastic.
You know, I thought it was fantastic, especially because I was looking at it. I was like, okay, any minute now, they're going to do my song.
Yeah.
But I forgot it's not the cartoon version.
Right,
it's the movie. It's not a musical.
Right.
It's a film. But I was looking for, be a man, I'm going to make a man out of you.
Yeah, be a man. And you know what? There were some deviations from the cartoon and connects to the movie. But, you know, the cinematic liberty.
But one of the things that they kept in there when she was running on the roof, remember in the cartoon,
she was running on the roof,
so she was running on the roof this time too. I love it. The whole thing was awesome.
You know,
the whole thing was awesome.
It really was. And I'm going to tell you, man, to get the backstory on the preparation that he put into his character as far as going to work with a blacksmith, that's unique. That's phenomenal. Because that's next level acting. You know what I mean? That's next level acting. You know, when you are delving so deep into that character where you're rather learning the backstory and whatever's not there, you have to create that, you know, for your own sense of script analysis and scene analysis and character development, right?
Yeah.
So there's going to be a lot of stuff that's not there that you're going to have to put there in some kind of way. Mm-hmm. And like I said, you know, when we were talking to him, his character was, the sidekick of Mulan by, you know, you want to say title or script description, but he really carved out his niche as his own person and character in the movie. So it was fantastic.
I love it. That was great. Yes, indeed.
That was great. That was fun.
Yes, that was great, man.
All right, so we're going to take a break?
Yep, we're going to take a break, and when we come back, it's going to be time for news and sports.
Scholars professional at any firm consists of a specialized group of academic doctors, editors, and statisticians that keep doctoral candidates moving through the academic doctoral process. The Scholars Group accepts doctoral dissertations, capstone projects, premise, research studies, research proposals, and oral defense preparations and presentations. The Scholars offer both qualitative and quantitative research assistant data analysis, dissertation editing, writing support, and mentorship through their boot camp 8-week online program. The Scholars Professional Editing Group will keep you moving. And for more information, visit www.thescholarsediting.com. That's www.thescholarsediting.com. Or contact Dr. Tamika Haynes at
281-315-6053. All right. So now it's time for news and sports.
All right. So in sports, it was a boxing weekend on pay-per-view. If Mike Tyson's fighting this pay-per-view.
You know what? You
don't know. That's in the past. Let's let the past be the past. They have since forgiven one another. They have since forgiven one another. They best friends. So anyway. All right. So the Charlo brothers fights results highlights. Jermell and Jermall Charlo successfully in their first pay-per-view main event. So the twins, and they're twins too. Mm-hmm. All right, so the twins.
Well, of course, Jermell and Jerchu. What is that?
Jermell and Jamal. Well, you don't necessarily have to be twins to have them names like that.
Well, normally people who have twins, they name the name similar.
Well, I know some people ain't twins. They name them. It's, yeah. they named them real close, and they ain't nothing like twins.
You get on my nerves.
Anyway, the twins put on quite the performance this past Saturday to retain in one case and unify titles in the other. A unique pay-per-view event gave boxing fans exactly what they had been hoping for on this past Saturday night. The Charlo twins, Jermell and Jermall, delivered the goods in a pay-per-view doubleheader with wins over Jason Rosario and Sergey Derevyanchenko, respectively. Mm-hmm. In the first main event, Jermall Charlo showed why he's one of the best middleweight boxers on the planet, in outlanding Derevyanchenko for a unanimous decision win to retain the WBC title. The older brother of the two twins looked crisp and his countenance and amazing with his defense, and he even evaded many of the heavy blows coming back from Derevyanchenko, who now has lost in his last three attempts at securing a title at 160 pounds. Then Jermell Charlo outslugged Rosario for a nasty finish in the eighth round to unify three of the four recognized titles at 154 pounds. Charlo was methodical in his approach and brushed off some of Rosario's early pressure to drop the native of the Dominican Republic twice before sitting him down for good in the eighth round. So CBS Sports will be with you throughout the unique pay-per-view event from Uncasville, Connecticut, and we live all of the coverage, highlights, and results below. So Charlo's versus Rosario fight card. Jermell Charlo defeats Josai Rosario via 8-round TKO. And then there were two other fights. We had Luis Neri defeated Aaron Almeida via unanimous decision, 116-112, 115-113, 118-110. And then Daniel Roman defeated Juan Carlos Payano via unanimous decision, 116-112, 116-112, 116-112, unanimous decision. And then Charlo versus Derevyanchenko fight card. This is the other brother. This is the younger brother. Mm. This is Jermall Charlo defeat Sergey Derevyanchenko via unanimous decision, 116-112, 117-111, 118-110. And then you have Brandon Figueroa defeats Damian Vasquez via 10th round TKO. And John Rio Casimiro defeated Duke Micah via 3rd round TKO. So it was a boxing weekend. It was some great fights. And they got some big fights to come. But we're going to keep you posted right here doing news and sports.
Yeah. We talked about Mike Tyson very briefly. You know, he's about to come out with his docuseries or something like that. Mm-hmm. And Robin Givens, the woman he was married to, she sent a cease and desist to the production company not to use any actors to play her because she don't want her character assassinated in the series.
I think she already assassinated her own character. I don't know. I'm not here to judge nobody. All I'm saying is Mike Tyson's an A-list actor. He be getting some roles, though, don't he?
He be getting some roles.
He gets roles.
He does.
I mean, he's in It Man. He's in Tyler Perry's movie. And you know, the majority of the roles, not all of them, he's going to end up punching somebody, knocking somebody out. You know, I think they be making fun of him.
I think they're making fun of him. He is enjoying his life. Yeah. Every time you see him, he smiled more than he did when he was boxing.
Yeah.
He is so happy. When I saw him in Madea Funeral, something like that, and he was the one that the mama was seeing at the end.
Right.
He was running up to the door to get out the car. Yes. He is having so much fun.
You know, and you can see it.
Yeah. You can see it all over his face that he is at such a peace.
Well, you know, and I'm happy for Mike, and I'm glad you're saying that because he did go through this phase where he was suicidal.
Yeah.
And of course, he lost his son. Remember that?
Like that.
So, I mean, one of the greatest heavyweights of our time.
Mm-hmm.
I want to say he's the youngest heavyweight to ever win a title.
Yeah.
knock on artists in his own right. I mean, people would pay a lot of money to go see his fights, and they would last less than a minute. And, you know, it's kind of sad to see that social downward spiral. But he's like, he's back on top doing his thing.
He's having a ball doing it.
Yeah.
He's having a ball doing it. So shout out to the pastors that talked to him, whoever talked to him to help him get back. He is like on top and he is having such a ball. Every time you see him, he's just cracking up. He's laughing. He's just enjoying himself. And it was more so than what it was when he was boxing. Right, it's just like,
and when he stopped boxing, when he first stopped boxing.
It's just like he was so evil then. You know, and I guess from everything that he was going through. But now he looks amazing. He looks amazing. He's always posting, you know, pictures, you know, him working out. He still got, you know, the boxer body and different things like that. Yeah. You know, he's having a ball, and I love to see him like this. You know what I mean? I would love to work with him and be in a movie with him, and he's like my uncle.
He's playing a drunk, you know?
He playing a drunk or whatever, you know, and it's like a comedy. And just to see him, you know, just to be around him, I get the feeling like now this Mike Tyson now walk into a room and just light it up. You know, it's shout out to Mike Tyson. You get the bell. So much joy, so much energy. I love it.
You know what? He still got his punch.
People ain't crazy now.
Yeah, he still got his punch. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. And I'm gonna tell you this. You know, there was speculation, I think, at one time that him and Evander Holyfield might do a charity event, and then I think it turned into Roy Jones Jr. And him. And I'm not sure anybody's still stepping in the ring with Mike.
No.
Because I saw the videos. Yeah. And he still got his speed and his age. He still got his punching power.
I prefer to see him right where he is right now on the camera.
Would you fight Mike Tyson for $1 million?
I'd be ducking and dodging, honey. I'd be jumping. I would. But he wouldn't catch me.
Okay.
Because I would be ducking.
Would you let Mike Tyson punch you one time?
$1 million? No. No.
Look, we get you.
No.
Listen, Nick, we'll take care of you afterwards.
You trying to kill me. No, listen. I knew you didn't like me. See?
No. We get you a wheelchair with a VCR.
No.
Right? You know what I'm saying?
No.
We'll take care of you afterwards. You had a month.
Y'all can put me in the ring.
It's like, no.
And for 60 seconds, I would be dodging the crap out of behind for 60 whole seconds.
No, we wouldn't.
Give me my money.
No, I wouldn't let you go in the ring.
I'm serious. 60 seconds, put me in the ring with him. He would not catch me.
Because
I'll be dodging the crap out of him for 60 seconds.
I'm gonna tell you this, but Mike know how to cut the ring off.
I know.
He know how to cut the ring
off. No, he won't catch me. I'm trying to tell you. And after that minute, when that bell go ding, I'm sliding underneath the thing, underneath the ropes. He ain't catching me. Pay up, give my money. I dodged him for a whole minute. I'm trying to tell you, he ain't trying to kill me.
I can see you there running between his legs.
Let me tell you,
crawling between his legs.
I sure would. I would be running between his legs and everything. He would not catch me.
No, we wouldn't put you in that situation.
We wouldn't want nothing to happen to you. Yeah, please don't. Please like me, okay? But it's nice to see you. Thank you very much.
It was just one of those what if situations.
Yeah, but it's just nice to see him smiling and just happy. It's nice to see him like that. And it looks good on you, Mike. It looks very good on you. Looks very good.
Yeah.
Well, in news, this one is hard because it's like, what do you do when you don't know what to do? What do you say when you don't know what to say? When it's just, you're not, you just throw your hands up like, you know what? Whatever is whatever. Breonna Taylor, the verdict came out and not one of those officers were charged. The officers were charged with bullets going into other people's houses of other different backgrounds. But they were not charged with Breonna Taylor's murder. And I'm telling you, social media is lit up like fire. Everybody is upset. I mean, from what I saw, some of the white people are upset too.
Well, let me say, let me put it how Whoopi Goldberg put it. Okay, because I chimed in. I was watching, you know, The View a little bit, kind of listened to the conversation. And what Whoopi Goldberg said, not that we want to make her the end-all, be-all reporting.
Yeah.
But what she said was the officer who got charged with, you know, whatever his charge was, endangerment that could have could have caused murder for a stray bullet going into a white and or a Caucasian woman's house.
Yeah.
But a stray bullet also went into an African-American woman's house. He didn't get charged with that. And he did not get charged with the death and or murder of Breonna Taylor. Yeah. And she goes on to say, and I quote, "This is crazy."
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And one of, they I can't remember who posted it, but there was a post by this Caucasian lady. You know, you have some Caucasian people who are upset, and you have some like, oh, whatever. But the post said, if this young girl had been of a Caucasian descent, all three officers would have been charged.
Right.
And the Caucasian person said, the only difference that is keeping the men out of jail is because that girl was black.
Yeah.
And she said, enough is enough. This has got to stop. I'm tired of seeing this on TV already.
Right.
Now, that's what she said. I'm tired of seeing it.
And you know, and this just reiterates why organizations like Black Lives Matter formed. Because the message that it sends to us as African Americans, that our lives don't matter.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? It's not a terrorist group. It's not a separatist group.
Right.
It's not a discriminatory group. It's a group that just wants to send the send a message that Black Lives Matter. You can actually put the T-O-O too. You know, then you have people throwing up All Lives Matter. Well, how come Black people aren't included in that All Lives?
Yeah.
So that slogan in and of itself is very hypocritical because Black people's lives aren't included in the All Lives. And it's not saying that all lives don't matter. It's just particularly, where, you know, it's kind of like when African Americans want to do something to support, celebrate just us, our culture, it always gets viewed, it tends to get viewed in a negative light.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And, but when other cultures do it, they don't get that same treatment.
No, they don't.
And it's just, you know, and it's just unfair. It is what it is. But this is just sad on every level.
It is sad. It's just sad on every level. It is sad on every level. And shout out to LeBron James. He was, well, we've all been, you know, speechless. But he was completely speechless. On, he put up a post and he just had a bunch of I'm sorries. And he said the most disrespected woman on the planet is the African-American woman. And so what he did was he threw up all of these names. I guess they were friends of his, female friends and relatives. And he was telling them all that, you know, he loved them. And he was charging the black men, you know, black men to stand up for their women of color and different things like that. You know, now we have women of color being cut down and nobody cares. And it's just one of them things where it truly hit home with, well, it been hit home with all of them, George Floyd, all of them, with the kneeling on his neck, and now there's no justice at all for Breonna Taylor. And then somebody put up on Facebook, well, she got $12 million, her family got $12 million, it's done. And, you know, I started to say something to that person.
You can't help.
I started
you can't
to,
help. You can't help.
But then I said, you know what? I'm not going to do it because one thing about God, God will return. What you put out, you're going to get back. That's one thing. God has no respect of person, and vengeance is mine. Thus saith the Lord, I shall repay. And I'm not saying that I want people of other nationalities and backgrounds to get killed and different things like that. What I'm saying is when it comes to your door, then you'll see what we're talking about.
And let's see if you have the same perspective.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
When it right now it's on our doorstep. You don't care. But when it comes to your door, let's see what happens. Let's see what happens.
Well, and then what if we just said, well, they'll just pay $12 million for your child.
Yeah.
Let's say you take a casual attitude then.
Right. So it's one of them things, you don't care unless it's on your doorstep. You should care about somebody's child. You should, because that child can be yours. You should care. You should care. That's it. That's all I got in news. All
right. That's enough.
We live in a careless world.
Yeah.
You know, live in a very careless world where you don't care you know, about what happens to other people. You don't care about a mother on her knees crying for her baby. You don't care. Mm-hmm. But when you have to fall down on your knees crying for your baby, let's see what happens. Mm-hmm. You know, yep. Let's see what happens.
Sometimes your perspective, it's going to be tested.
Yeah, that's it right there. Mm-hmm. It's going to be tested. Because I'm going to tell you right now, God is watching. Mm-hmm. God is watching, and he watching how we handle situations. He watching all of this. Mm-hmm. He watching it. It's going to get to a point where he going to be like, you know what? No more watching. It's time to start doing. He going to do some things. Good and we're going to see what's going to happen.
Your turn.
Yup. Yep. Tag. You're it.
Yeah. All right.
That's it. That's all I got.
All right. So we're going to take another break.
Yes.
We're going to take a break. And when we come back, it's going to be time for my favorite part of the show. We're going to find out what's bothering Nikee. It's the Kevin and Nikee Show on iHeartRadio. We're everywhere. And
we will be right back. Make a man out of you. Be a man, mysterious as the dark side of the moon. I'm gonna make a man out of you. That's what I love that song. Mm-hmm. I love that song.
That's the cartoon Disney soundtrack. That's the original, right?
Love
there.
That. That's the original. Yeah. I love it. That's it. I love it.
Mulan.
I love it.
Now it's time for my favorite part of the show. We're going to find out what's bothering Nikki. What's bothering you, Nikki?
Fences. Where do you stand? On one side of the fence or the other side? Which side of the fence are you going to be on? You can't be on both sides. Which side of the fence are you going to be on? When that boomerang comes back at you and slap you right in the face, what you going to do? Mm-hmm. This Breonna Taylor thing, you know, the George Floyd thing, had a lot of people straddling the fence, mm-hmm. had a lot of people on one side, a lot of people on the other side. Which side of the fence you going to be on? I'm telling you right now, I'd rather be on the side that's loyal, brave, and true than be on the other side, because when that boomerang come back around, I do not want it to hit me, but it's going to hit you. It's going to hit you. Care about somebody other than yourself. Mm-hmm. Care about what people are going through other than yourself. Because when that boomerang come back, you're going to want somebody to care about you.
Yeah.
Shout out these people who have pain and who are going on pain and persecution, all that kind of stuff. Because when it comes back on you, you're going to want somebody to come to your door, knock on your door and say, hey, I'm sorry to hear about what you're going through. But if you don't care about nobody else but yourself, it's not going to come back. What side of the fence are you on? What side of the fence do you want to get caught on when the Lord start coming back and doing some stuff? Yeah. That's it. That's all I got.
Enough said.
That's it.
All right. So,
we're going to take another break. And when we come back, it's going to be time for my favorite part of the show, Kevin's Corner. It's the Kevin and Nikee Show on iHeartRadio. We're everywhere. We will be right back.
Sure. Why fight the tide? Don't think so much. Let your heart decide. Baby, I see a future and it's tied to mine. Look in your eyes and see you searching for a sign. But you'll never fall till you let go. Don't be scared of what you don't know. True to your heart, you must be true to your heart. Shower you with my love. Open your eyes. Your heart can tell you no lies. And when you're true to your heart, I know it's gonna lead you straight to me. Someone you know is on your side can set you free. I can do that for you if you believe in me. What feels so right? Just trust your heart, and you'll see the light. True to your heart, you must be true to your heart. It's with the hands of God, and baby, shower you with my love. Open your heart can tell you no lies. And when you're true to your heart, I know it's gonna lead you straight to me. Straight to me. Open your heart, and
To the Kevin and Nikee Show on iHeartRadio. Yeah. Right. You go speak to the high.
That's Stevie, man. He's a musical genius.
Love it. Oh, my goodness. Musical genius. Stevie Wonder. Prince, Michael Jackson, all of them.
That's it.
Musical genius.
Yeah, Stevie, he still sound good.
He's always sound good. Yes, always sound good.
Yeah. He was the one that gave us the black happy birthday song, right?
Yeah.
Is that okay to call it the Black
Happy
Birthday song?
You get on my nerves. It was for Dr. Martin Luther King.
Oh, yeah, it was Dr. Martin Luther King. Okay.
You get on my nerves.
Yeah. Now, anybody can sing it. You know, everybody's welcome.
You get on my nerves.
That was who it originated from and for.
Yes.
But all cultures are welcome.
Yes. All right. Now it's time for my favorite part of the show. Kevin's Corner.
All right, we're going to keep the high vibration train moving.
Choo-choo.
We're trying to raise our vibration every day.
Yes.
Number 77. We got two more characteristics, number 122 and 123. We're going to start up with 122. We're still dealing with the signs that one is operating on a high vibration and frequency in life. And you know what? This has been getting so good, so we've been keeping it going, so we're going to keep it going.
Hello.
So, now, I just thought this was so fitting. Because it's so in line with our theme, our special guest, and Mulan.
Mm-hmm.
You talked about it on With Bother and Nikee, I want to say last week or the week before that. And it's, you bring honor to yourself.
Yeah.
That's how you know you on a high vibration. You bring honor to yourself.
That's right.
All right? To honor oneself is to respect, admire, and appreciate yourself.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
To honor thyself is not to rise to nobility, but it is a way to respect yourself and give yourself the admirations that's due. And this has nothing to do with being prideful. It's just loving on you. To honor ourselves means that we look after and show ourselves as much love and kindness as we might show other people in our life. And this is okay.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we're not even told this. And so probably hearing this probably sounds weird. But by honoring it, dismiss everything that interferes with your dream, goals, aspirations, and embrace everything that encourages it.
Mm-hmm.
Let go of self-hatred, fear, unnecessary obligations, naysayers, the past, and especially doubt, worry, and unbelief.
Mm-hmm.
And instead, honor yourself with kindness, encouragement, inspiration, motivation, time, and effort, support, belief, and love. Which brings me to my next point. Nick touched on it a week ago or 2 weeks ago. You bring honor to your family and friends.
That's right.
And we talked about that, right?
We did.
So, it is an abstract concept involving the perceived quality of worthiness and respectability that affects the social standing. We're going to add holistic. That means spiritual, mental, emotional, intellectual, financial, vocational, relational, dream, goals, and aspirational, and the self-evaluation of a group of related people, both corporately and individually. The ideology and practice of family honor varies from country to country, but the question is, we take into consideration our thoughts, our feelings, our words, and most importantly, our actions. Are we bringing honor to ourselves and to our family and friends? Because when we think about it, the legacy that we are going to pass down, the lives of those who are coming behind us depend on. So will we break the chains or repeat the negative cycle? The choice is ours. That's it.
Love it. Love it. Love everything about it.
That's it.
That's it.
You know, that's if you want to set a legacy of being in courtrooms and handcuffs, don't get upset when little brother is in the courtroom with handcuffs.
That's right.
You want to set a legacy of financial blessings and breakthrough, well, you're setting little brother and little sister up for financial blessings and breakthrough.
That's right.
You want to set a precedence and a legacy of being thrown in jail and all that stuff. Don't get upset when little sis gets thrown in jail. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. You want to set a precedence of dream goals and aspirations being set in place and being business owners and being successful. Well, little sis will be right in line to fall in place.
That's it.
We got to break these chains, man.
That's it.
And we got to recreate new cycles of success and things like that.
That's it. People are watching you. Our kids are watching us.
Mm-hmm.
And we don't want them growing up being evil, mm-hmm, and carrying on. Change the way you are.
Yeah. Kids are going to pick up not only what you say, but what you do. They're going to pick up your attitudes.
Yep.
They're going to pick up your mannerism. They're going to pick up the attitude, energy, some call it spirit, mm-hmm, or the vibration, mm-hmm, behind who you are.
Mm-hmm.
And they're going to reenact that.
Yeah.
You know, they're going to reenact that.
Yeah.
So if you are someone who is full of negativity and hate and dislike and all that stuff, your children are going to pick it up, even if you're not saying a word. But if you're full of happiness, joy, encouragement, motivation, celebration, well, they're going to pick that up too.
Mm-hmm.
That's it.
That's it. All right.
All right.
Put it out there.
All right. Thank you guys from the top, middle, and bottom of our hearts for tuning in each week. As long as y'all keep tuning in,
yeah,
we're going to keep it coming. You guys are our motivation, inspiration, and y'all are our high vibration.
That's right.
We do what we do for you. We can't do what we do without you. And we just want to say we love you. You're always in our thoughts and prayers, and we appreciate you guys so much. So I'm actor Kevin D. Benton. You can find me on Facebook, Kevin D. Benton, on Twitter, at Kevin D. Benton, on Instagram, actor Kevin D. Benton. You can find us on YouTube, actor Kevin D. Benton, and actress Nikee Warren. Check us out.
Yes, you can find me on Facebook, Nikee Warren, on Twitter, at Nikee Warren, and on the gram. Hello, I'm Nikee, spelled H-E-L-L-O-I-M-N-I-K-E-E. You can find our show, The Kevin Nikee Show, on Facebook, at Kevin Nikee Show on Twitter, and The Kevin Nikee Show on the gram.
Mm-hmm.
If you have any questions, comments, concerns for our special guest,
Mr. Chen Ying Tang,
hit us up, KevinNikkeeShow at yahoo.com. We'll read it to him, get the answer, and read it back. And like we always say, who knows, your letter can be featured on our show. Hey, listen, once again, thank you for your many birthday wishes, and thank you for shouting out Kev on his debut Power, and thank you for being you.
Yes.
Somehow I was getting up there, right?
I was about to ask you to take it a little bit higher.
Take it a little bit higher. Thank you so much. We truly appreciate all the love that you have shown us. Thank you. And you guys make this journey worth walking.
You know what? We need to give our listeners the bell. Y'all get the bell, baby.
Get the bell and the clapper. Thank you. Yeah. Thank you. All right. Yes.
All right. So that's it.
That's it.
All right. So we're the Kevin and Nikee Show on iHeartRadio. We are everywhere, and we are
out of here.
Peace.
Look at me, you may think you see who I really am, but you'll never know me. Every day, it's as if I play a part. Now I see, if I wear a mask, I can fool the world, but I cannot fool my heart.
You have been listening to The Kevin and Nikki Show on iHeartRadio.